That's it. That's. I'm not hearing myself, Mr. Technician.
I hear you, Calvin.
Do you hear me?
I do.
Okay, well, I don't hear
Loud
myself.
And clear.
Okay, so this is another edition of NJ Discover Radio Show Live with Tyra Jean Vitale and myself. Before, I'm Calvin. Before I do a station identification, so before we proceed, this is, and before I even proceed with proceeding, I want to say this is a very special edition of our show because I'm sitting here looking at the director and the producer and the cast of the Soulless, and there's a whole entourage here, which is a proper theatrical term to use, and we're going to get to them shortly, but let me do the obligatory station ID and tag. So everybody out there in television land and radio land, remember what you did last time. You're listening to NJ Discover Radio. To find out more, go to njdiscover.com or follow us on Facebook, NJ Discover production page. You can also follow us on Twitter at NJ Discover. And it gives me, it always does, and it never diminishes. It gives me great pleasure always to introduce my effervescent, ebullient, wonderful co-host, Tyra Jean Vitale.
Thank you, Calvin. And I want to introduce Calvin Schwartz, the amazing, he's a writer, he's a radio host, and TV. So you do everything, Calvin.
And change light bulbs.
And change light bulbs.
Yes, yes. Correct. No ladder.
Because he's very tall.
No ladder, no ladder.
Extremely tall. How tall are you, Calvin?
6'5 and a half.
That's nice.
And actually, I'm at a fairly advanced age, and I was very worried looking at pictures with my son and I, and it would appear, because at my age, you know, the bones start to compress.
Yeah.
And I was very worried that I was losing some of that precious height. So I had a full physical not too long ago, and they completely ignored checking my height, and I went back, and I had them check my height.
Really?
And lo and behold, not have I lost not a millimeter.
That's because of all the vitamins.
I've maintained
That's because
my height.
Because you exercise and you take care of your body, you take vitamins, yes. So you're a healthy man.
Yes, yes, yes.
Wonderful.
So let's move on. And what did you...
And what have we done since the last radio show?
Sure.
Well, we had the radio show for the Garden State Film Festival, so we went to see the film. And you saw two films. Well, we saw a couple of films,
yes,
actually.
Yes,
but
we did.
Distressed, I saw, which won.
Yes.
And then we had Rick Zahn, a friend of ours.
Correct.
Did he win also?
I'm not sure.
But P.J. Monaco.
Yeah, P.J. Bracco.
Bracco, yeah.
He
won.
He won a music
video. It's amazing.
Video.
The people we had on
yes.
had won from the film festival.
So we have a so golden touch.
You picked good ones.
I did. I did.
Next year,
of
course.
I was thinking
we'll
of that.
There. Yeah, definitely.
By the way. I'm thinking of that. Make no mistake about that.
Mm-hmm.
We'll come see you next year.
So that was in Atlantic City.
Yes.
Will it be in Atlantic City next year?
For 3 years.
I hope so, because I liked it there. It was
Bob,
really
is it?
Exciting.
Bob is one of the...
He's on the board.
I'm on the board.
Oh, okay, good.
For the film festival.
Excellent. Loved it. Had a great time.
We'll be there next year.
And Easter just passed, so I went to visit family in Rockaway Beach, and that was beautiful. You know, they're finally building and rebuilding back there after Sandy, so that was
right.
a really nice thing to
okay.
see the,
okay.
you know, the sand coming back and people out on the beach.
Wonderful.
So, yeah.
Wonderful.
So what else did we do? Oh, then, of course, we saw the sneak peek of the Soulless.
Last Friday.
Yeah.
Yes, Friday night.
Yes,
that
Friday
was
night.
Great.
Very
Which
privileged.
So
few people
excited.
Got
I
to see a little bit ahead of time.
And we feel privileged.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we'll talk about that shortly.
Yeah.
Very
now,
shortly.
What about you, Calvin? What have you been doing?
Well, I want to jump right in because there's so much to do here tonight, but I just want to jump into the segment because cerebrally, this segment, which I started doing a couple of shows ago, called Things That Scare the Hell Out of Me. And in deference to...
That's right.
And I'm going to tie this in. Watch how I creatively tie this into the Soulless because having seen the sneak peek on Friday, I was so moved. And I felt, seriously, I'm really emotional, and I felt very apocalyptical, if that's a proper term.
Yes.
Is
yes.
it, Chris?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I felt very apocalyptical, and it made me do a lot of research in conjunction with the Soulless. So these are the things. There's a couple of things here that scare the hell out of me. And such that I'm so moved, I may be moved actually now to write a second novel based on, and I mentioned this to Chris back at the house.
I want this book dedicated to me. But.
Well, it will be because you, and the cast and Bob,
the cast and crew of the Soulless, yes.
You were the accelerant to this mindset that I have. So, Gary Pastor, two weeks ago when I did this segment, Things That Scare the Hell Out of Me, he sang Kumbaya. So this is now the Kumbaya segment. So these are things which scare the hell out of me, and watch how it ties in to the Soulless.
Well, I'm hoping this film ties into a number of fears people have. And the things that we tend to take for granted in our world right now.
And we take a lot for granted. Mm-hmm. So, NASA. There's just two things. Actually, I have a list of about 10, but we're just not going to do those. But NASA, the space agency, was involved in a study. And because of the volatility of this study, they deferred and gave all the information to a couple of mathematicians. But the essence of the study is we only have a few decades left as a species.
Stop it.
Well, yeah.
I don't believe it.
Well, yeah. We only have a few decades left. You see how it's
Don't tell my
tying?
Children that.
You see how neat? And
we'll have to evolve into a new species. Good idea for a movie.
Yeah, well, there you go. See how it's all... mm-hmm. But they based their... And NASA doesn't want anything to do with this, so they just gave it to these mathematicians who figured it out and computed it. And it makes a lot of sense to me. Based on population, climate, water, agriculture, and energy, which we're running out of everything, and looking back on past histories, this could very well happen. And the other ingredient... And the other ingredient to the demise of our species is the economic stratification where you have elites and poor people. And then a few shows ago, I came
and
up
no
with
no middle class anymore.
No middle class. And that's going to create tremendous social unrest.
There have been a number of times in our history we've hit these kind of peaks. And remember, the mother of invention is necessity. I believe we're going to find the way to feed the people. We're going to find a way to do this. I know the calculations right now are not good, and I hope my grandkids have a better life than these people are predicting. But we've adapted as a species throughout time. It's a kind of it's these technological changes that we have coming that we can adapt to that scare the heck out of me.
Well,
and that's part of what the film is about. Global warming.
Yeah.
Of course, we've gone through that throughout the history of the Earth, and
so it's a great tie-in to the film.
Yes, I actually read recently that we came as a species within 10,000 people of becoming extinct 10,000 years ago, I believe, during an ice age, and that's coming as close as you can as a species to extinction. But we recovered from that. So,
We rely too much. Again, what I read, we rely too much on technology in and of itself. So, I mean, I don't, part of my shtick here is I don't want to elaborate too much. I'm just throwing this out. But when they talked about the economic stratification of the masses, it's elites and poor people. I came up with this statistic a couple of shows ago that the top 85 richest people in the world, their accumulated wealth is richer than the poorest 3.5 billion people on Earth. So that's some of the stuff that's fueling it. And then
we're a country now because of something like that. And you know what happens? It's called revolution.
Well,
you hear the
people sing? There you go. Okay. Anyway, we don't want to dwell on that. We want to really.
Kaylin plays a character in The Soulless, who's probably relying on technology at the beginning and then suddenly doesn't have it. What would be your perspective, Kaylin, of a teenage girl suddenly without batteries and cell phones and the internet and having it cut off rather immediately? How would you respond to that?
Well, I'm not really that attached to technology, but I would probably not respond very well because I'm addicted to about 9 billion TV shows. They're like drugs. I hate them.
Well, that's technology. But what if you're suddenly you didn't know how such a show was going to continue and never would find out.
I don't even know what I would do with them. I'd probably just sit on the floor like, what is life?
Okay.
So I have to do with myself.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. The last part of my things that scare the hell out of me is Princeton University just did a study, and it said the United States is no longer an actual democracy but an oligarchy because most of the United States is being controlled by a handful of rich people. End of
my
segment.
Goodness.
This is the end of Kumbaya, but you see how it does tie into the Soulless. And now, it gives me great pleasure. I'm going to go around to the group. Chris, Chris Eilenstine is the director of the Soulless. And Bob, why don't you jump in? Bob Cleary is the producer. Why don't you jump in and say a few words, Bob?
Well, do you want to go for how we met or how we got this thing
whatever
started?
Whatever you'd like.
Sure.
Well,
who
Chris
the
and I,
heck are you, Bob? Let us know.
Let me see. I have about 40 films under – I have about 5 films and about 40 plays under my belt. And in the meantime, Chris reached out to me for a a webisode he did called Jurassic Justice Force.
I was developing a TV series, and I did a series of very low-budget little – webisodes to kind of introduce writers and people to the concepts of the show, and Bob was played a general.
And then we were associated with a another flick, Haunted Sleigh Ride, and then with Steve Hersicorn, I wrote a movie called MacGuffin, and the first person I reached out to was Chris, and Chris was our director, and did a phenomenal job. And
thank you.
We still have that to edit. And then we got associated with doing the idea of him coming out with Soulless. So I put my full producing background involved, and I have Lionheart LLC. You can go see it at
Bob is a natural producer. He knows everybody. You know, there's 6 degrees of separation in the world. I think there's about 2 degrees of separation with Bob. He can call a police department and say, oh, we're filming this week. Leave them alone. And they will. And it's just amazing to have him as a producer.
Only if you ask him if they want to be part of the movie. That works, too, you know.
I did have a police officer volunteer his mother-in-law to play a zombie. But other than that, they left us alone. They were great.
And going on, we have another movie coming up, which is a actually not a spin-off of this one, but we'll be spinning off into another production, Trailer Heaven, which you'll get to meet Mike Chartier, who's been in both those other movies, by the way. And now he wrote a phenomenal one that we're going out right now looking for funding.
Financing. Mm-hmm.
Funding. So.
So when you guys met and the idea of the Soulless, how was it presented? Did you have it written already? What did you have done?
He had the concept.
Just the concept.
He had the
okay.
concept and the idea, and so I put together I helped as much as I could with
equipment, and locations,
and personnel, and
casting,
because
really,
we had a wealth
really
of,
minor
we had,
kind of things.
Yeah,
you know?
We had a wealth. I've been lucky to have a wealth of people to draw from.
Now, with your casting, did you put out a casting call, or
no,
did you know
we,
a lot of these people?
We really didn't. We know enough people in our time. Yeah. I mean,
we have so many. The community theater world of that we know has so much talent pool there. For example, I wrote the role of Dr. Riker for Michael with him in mind because I knew what he was capable of, and it's amazing to see. But Ed Young, who's here, amazing actor. I'd work with him.
Edward X. Young, please.
Edward X. Young, yes. I can't forget the X. Just an amazing pool of actors. I worked with Jennifer Tesco, who plays Nicole Peterson in the last 2 films of The Soulless. And Kaylin, I worked with on the webisodes, and I remember them. They had a scene together, and I remember going, "Wow, they look similar." Kaylin really looks similar to Jennifer at that age. And then I said, "When I'm making this film, I have a character with 2 different ages." And I said, "I got 2 wonderful actresses who look the same, the right age. Everything fell into place for this film." Once you know you have a good cast, proceed. that that's the challenge, mm-hmm. is getting the right people in the right place.
That's the same thing we heard from the other filmmakers, remember?
Yes.
The cast.
Yes.
It is true. Once you get your casting done, a director's job really, really falls into place.
Mm-hmm. And the relationship in this movie between the father and the daughter, and you'll see the daughter in the movie growing, you know, from 10 to 20s, and that's the essence. And that those two roles had to really be the pivotal part, mm-hmm. of it. And they a tremendous job, especially.
Well, Jason Probst, who plays David Peterson, the father, throughout the series, I'd worked with him briefly on MacGuffin,
right.
And he was in a straitjacket with a shaggy beard.
The man who knew too much.
And I'd lost the guy I had in mind for David Peterson, and I said, "Oh gosh, I'm in trouble. I don't have an actor." And Stephen Hirsikorn's wife, Mary, said, "Well, what about the guy in the back?" I go, "The guy in the straitjacket with the scraggy beard?" I said, "Well, I'll meet with him." But it worked out beautifully. He's an amazing performance.
A dynamic performance. Yeah.
I think what we need to do at this point is, I think you need to let the audience know the Soulless, what mm-hmm. it is and what it's about, what you want them to know about it right now.
Okay.
Because we're giving away little things about, like, fathers and daughters. And just what's the story about?
The Soulless is a science fiction horror drama about a father and daughter surviving the apocalypse. And basically the beginning of the film involves a genetic mutagen, something that changes people's DNA being released, and how it affects the people of the Earth. It causes a 98% mortality rate in children, so there are really no children left. But David Peterson and Nicole Peterson are very special people, and throughout the series we find out how they've been changed by this plague and how they will basically be reshaping and guiding mankind back to normality.
Okay.
And
let's continue with introducing. Let's introduce Kaylin Iannone.
Yeah, I'm Kaylin Iannone.
Okay. Say a couple words.
I actually met Chris through the webisodes that he did. I had to bring in a bunch of little dinosaur toys to sit on the stairs and talk to Jennifer. That was fun.
Okay.
Have you always wanted to be an actress?
Yeah, when I was really little, I wanted to be a vet. But once I got into community theater, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is my thing.
She has no choice now. When this film comes out, she will be an actress.
Whether I like it or not.
You will like it.
Okay, Alex. Jump to the microphone.
Hi, I'm Alex Gonzalez. I actually met Chris through Kaylin. She asked me if I wanted to be in the movie because Chris needed extra zombies. And then once Chris, saw everything, he wanted me to be, an extra person because he made an extra person. So I said, sure, I'll give it a try. And it's really fun, and I really like it.
Yeah, the character that you play is very lovable. You know, you just love her.
It's the linchpin
right
of the movie in a lot of ways.
She brings so much to the movie.
Alex plays Melissa, which is a young girl that David and Nicole befriend and save. It's really her relationship with Nicole, Melissa, and Nicole's relationship that kind of shapes that character and how she will grow and respond in life from that point on. Melissa is one of the few children that survived this plague, and she's a little ragamuffin that survived on her own through this horrendous experience for 9 months and then finds David and Nicole in the middle of the film.
Okay.
Did you create the character when you met her?
No, I had it in mind for the TV series, and I didn't know what the budget and so forth we had. And I didn't have an actress that I thought could pull it off at the time. So it's really when I met Alex and I had this place called Lousy Land that Russ, another producer on the film, Russ Busey, provided for us, that I knew I could start to expand from an abridged version of my story to the unabridged.
Mm-hmm.
When you get somebody that's really good and these two had a chemistry that works for what we're doing, I knew I could do it. I knew it would work.
And it's like synchronicity, right, Calvin?
Yes, synchronicity.
Everything
meant
just
to be.
Kind of falls into place.
I know, it's a matter of knowing your story so well that you can adapt to what you're given and make it work. And when I've been given these wonderful actors, I said, I'm going to make this work.
And you did.
Yep. Thank you.
Joe, jump up to the microphone.
Sure. It's Joe Parascand. I play Sergeant Benton, And just a little background, I had, when speaking to Chris about this character, just when he told me about it, I said, geez, this guy looks like, seems like he'll be a combination of Michael Ironside's character in Starship Troopers and maybe Lee Marvin's in The Dirty Dozen. And so when I mentioned that, he said, yeah, I think you probably have that. So we were pretty much in sync from the beginning. And
a little bit of Robert E. Lee.
Really enjoyed it, that's for sure. And how can you not with wonderful people like the ones you have here?
Right. No, thank you, Joe.
And you've done acting before? What have you done?
Well, I actually was a latecomer.
Trilogy.
I'm 52 now. I didn't get into this until I was 41. I got laid off from Bell Labs back in 02.
Ah.
Stumbled into it pretty much. And then stopped in 06, got back in 2010 on the side. And I was in another trilogy, which is about to wrap up, as a matter of fact. Part
as
three
premiere,
of that, called Witch's Blood, will premiere in about a week, this Saturday at 7:30, at a convention called Chiller Theater. But I was in part one of that trilogy called Mary Horror. Then there was a Sheriff Tom versus the Zombies, which is part two. And a woman named Genevieve Rossi, who plays Officer Elling, my second in command, if you will, in the Soulless here.
Mm-hmm.
I had introduced her to Ryan Scott Weber for that trilogy. He's that director. And she wound up playing Jojo, the seance leader there. When it came time to cast Sergeant Benton, I guess the two of them talked, and she recommended me, and lo and behold,
well,
a nice little swap
here. I didn't have my Sergeant Benton. Sergeant Benton is kind of the general or team leader of the Soulless, which is a group of people immune to zombie attack, and their nickname, the Soulless, that's where the title of the film comes from. You find out how they're named that in the second film. But I said, I don't have a Sergeant Benton, and then anybody who could be cast as a Sheriff Tom would have to be a pretty good choice. So I met with Joe, and it turned out once again to be just fate that he's perfect in this film. There are scenes that he has with Jason Props that are going to make people just absolutely bawl their eyes out. That just great scenes.
Did we see him in the sneak peek?
He's going to be
No,
he hasn't been... No. I'm going to have a kind of a scene with him and his daughter on Z-Day, very brief scene.
Okay.
So when he shows up in the second film, you go, oh, that's the guy we saw in the first film on Z-Day, and you find out that he lost his daughter and how basically the loss of children in this movie is what shapes every character. Even before Z-Day, there's a main character who's lost a child, and that shapes the end of the world, basically, this loss of child. That's the theme of the film is family, and if we were to all lose our children once a whole generation, like say happened to Germany in World War I, how would we really deal with it? And that's part of the recovery process of the world in this film.
Next up, I'm looking at you, Michael.
Well, speaking of Germany in World War I, I'm glad I don't have to speak with a German accent here with Chris.
Well, you can if you'd like, Michael.
No.
As I introduce Michael, I want to pay Michael a huge compliment. And I mentioned this to you before we went on air, and it was a huge compliment. As it turns out, I have a bit of a cameo in this movie, and that's why there's a great spot in my heart.
Yes, when I met you, I said I want Cal Schwartz to play the reporter for this.
So he asked me if I wanted to play myself, and I happen to be fairly proficient at playing myself.
Ever since you were a teenager.
Yeah, ever since I was a teenager, yes. So anyway, so Michael and I played a reporter, and Michael is Dr. Hans Reicher, and we did this scene.
Hans Reicher.
So, but anyway, we did the scene, and I just, and I informed you like
glory boy of genetics.
A year later that while we were doing that, And because of your act, this is my point, Michael. Because of your acting ability, I really disliked you intensely.
Well, thank you very much, Cal. I dislike you too.
I really disliked you, and I almost
this has
came
been a
out
year
of character.
Now.
I came out of character, and I really want to give you a shove, which is testament to your acting. So, say hello, Michael.
Hello, Cal. Thank you very much. Okay. You know, even though you had bad feelings about me, thank you very much for inviting me on your show today. Cal,
I thought it was just acting, Cal. But
Cal, we have to tell them that the first dialogue scene in The Soulless was ours.
It's the first thing we shot.
Correct.
And at that point in time, we really didn't have any idea where these characters were going to go. And that's when
my method directing at work.
This is where we started to hear the wheels turning in Chris's head.
Well, so
this goes here and this goes here, and that's
I knew where it went and kind of what I wanted said, but I knew if I got you guys together, it would work out.
And it worked. It was great chemistry, and there's still some lingering animosity, but
you have to understand one thing.
I want to see you guys hug at the end of this.
I've known Chris for an extremely long period of time. 25 years.
Yes.
We first met at a
the Meadow Theater in
Children's
Red
Theater
Bank.
That was at one time in the Galleria in Red Bank, which was produced by a dear friend of mine, Drew Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And we met there. I had written a show that eventually went to the Minetta Lane Theater in New York City called Far Out, which was a sci-fi musical. And Chris was my scenic designer for that show. He designed all the alien creatures,
monsters,
the puppetry,
and special
everything
effects
that went along with it.
The little model that crashes at the beginning of the movie and the show.
I had also done a series of other things for Chris. I was involved in your first webisode project.
Yes.
And that was basically my introduction to Chris. As far as the filmmaker was concerned, and then we had also done a read-through of a piece that you had written.
Which I hope to be my next film, which I possibly will direct. It's called Victim 17, but I'm actually looking for a co-director right now for that, and Mr. Edward X. Young over here and I are talking about that right now. But it's been a great relationship for 25 years now.
And you also have to understand that this gentleman to my right, Mr. Edward X. Young, and I have known each other for even a longer period of time.
Probably 35
years.
35 years.
Wow.
Now, have you been acting for a long time?
Yeah.
I can tell.
Mm-hmm.
You're definitely an actor. You've got that actor thing. You were great, absolutely wonderful in the show.
Thank you. He needed some kind of antagonist in the piece. But I'm more or less, I'm not really an antagonist. I'm more or less a troubled individual.
No, we all hated you by the end.
Michael is one of those people, as soon as he speaks, you have to look
yes.
at the voice
Absolutely.
And where it's coming from, and that's what I needed to center. The father-daughter relationship and a strong performance to set the plot in motion was necessary. And you'll see in the second and third films how central the Riker character is to the whole trilogy.
He doesn't get to use it now, but he's also a great singer.
Really? Sing for us.
I can add a scene.
You're putting me on the spot.
You have to do something.
Yeah, twist his arm.
Kaylin and I will sing a song sometime, okay?
Okay.
Nice.
So that brings us to Edward X. Young.
Yes, I am Edward X. Young, and as Michael Chartier pointed out, we've known each other about 35 years. Way back in the 70s, we met when I was working in the community theater circuit. We did a number of plays together. I dropped out of acting and went into the corporate world for a while and moved away from the area.
No!
I know. Probably was a mistake, but I actually had lost touch. I'd moved back to New Hampshire where I'd grown up, too. But I've gotten back into acting 9 years ago. In the past 9 years, as an actor and or makeup effects artist, I've worked in over 60 independent horror, science fiction, and fantasy pictures.
Wow.
Nice. I've directed one movie, Two Guys, One Box, which features Rock and Roll Hall of Fame legend Lee Black Childers, who just died a few weeks ago.
Wow.
But if you want to look for my films in stores, a lot of them are available everywhere on Netflix.
Mr. Hush is the most recent one that's gotten a lot of attention.
Mr. Hush is my most commercially available film. You could find it everywhere.
Yes.
I play the titular role of Mr. Hush. Also, Mold by Neil Machino is available everywhere. And you could get my movie Sea of Dust on Netflix.
With Tom Savini.
With Tom Savini and Ingrid Pitt. Ingrid Pitt Hammer.
Vampire Lovers.
Yeah, her swan song performance.
I've seen that. That is a great film, and Ed is fantastic.
Wow.
And I also sing in the proto-punk legendary rock and roll band, David Peel and the Lower East Side. I'm a vocalist in the band.
Wow.
David is still going strong for the past...
John Lennon...
That's right. He's been doing this for about 48 years. He's been doing this. We actually sang at the outside of City Hall in New York City yesterday for the National Marijuana Day festivities.
Ed just can't remember very well. Okay. He was there.
Actually, I got to make this clear. I lead a clean and sober lifestyle, but I'm a strong proponent for the medical use of marijuana.
If you were within a half a mile radius of the event, you could no longer say that.
I did enjoy meeting Bernard Goetz at that convention yesterday.
Kidding. He was there?
Yes, he is. He's actually a big proponent for the legalization of weed.
Wow.
And he's also a very aggressive proponent of veganism. And I'm vegan currently also.
I'm a transhumanist. I'm sorry, I'm a flexitarian.
What was that now?
I'm a flexitarian.
I think he's revealing too much.
I haven't eaten anything with four legs since 1975. But I haven't officially crossed over to veganism yet because I'm still looking for a source of protein. We'll talk about that later.
I've been a vegetarian on and off over the years.
Now, humans only have two legs.
Okay.
But I will say that I got kind of out of shape recently. In the Soulless, I play Dr. Cooper, wonderful mad scientist role that Chris created specifically for me. He originally hired me as a makeup effects artist.
Yes. Okay. Then I saw Mr. Hush, and I go, this guy acts? Why didn't he tell me this? You know, I've worked with him on some films, and he came in and poured the blood and set up the wires and the pumps and everything to squirt the blood everywhere.
I did pyrotechnic effects.
I had no idea
too.
He was such a good actor. I mean, a wonderful actor. And I said, well, I now have my Cooper. So
I asked Chris if I'd really appreciate it if he would write a role for me, and he tailored this beautiful role for me, a real, like, classic Vincent Price type mad doctor role. Very proud of it. I have a wonderful monologue in it too.
Well, I love his line where he goes, "There's 8 billion people on this earth, all with different ideology, religions, and everybody capable of destroying each other, and everybody else thinks they're right. Everybody else is wrong. And well, Hans, we know what we know. We're scientists. We know where this equation's going, which is oblivion. So basically, Dr. Cooper sets things in motion to reboot humanity, as he puts it. He goes." We don't have a chance for survival, so I'm going to set us back to the beginning and start things over. And that's how the Soulless begins.
I like that.
He's 90, and he's 98% successful where the human race is sent back to its primitive beginnings before fire, before humanity, basically, and the intellect began. Pure instinct survived minute to minute. And those are our zombies in the movie. I mean, it's not the traditional zombie coming out of the ground Walking Dead type of zombie. It's new. It's going to be. It's terrifying. I think of the idea of waking up one morning and the whole world is a bunch of Cro-Magnon men that you can't reason with. I would be more scared of them than I would be the shambling little zombies from The Walking
because
Dead.
Because in a typical movie, the zombies who are dead come back to life.
Right.
But that's not what happens here.
Spoiler alert, I'm not going to go into that, but
we try.
When the Soulless is done, people will think of the zombie genre differently. I mean, we do have the tagline of forget everything you know about the living dead, the rules have changed, and you'll know why by the end of the third film.
I'm very proud of some of the special effects I did for Chris in the movie. I don't know how he edited it. There was a really great massacre scene. It was Sam Peckinpah would have been proud of it.
With Kaylin and the wind-up toy, and she gets splattered in the face, and the blood squirting from the zombie that
Jason
dispatches. It worked quite well.
I love creating kinetic gore effects where
the
makeup
Alex
splatters
over here too,
everywhere.
Remember?
Yeah. Really
gross. That was the.
I have some spectacular. Some of my best throat cuttings are in this movie. I do some decapitations, disembowelments, amputations.
I don't want people to think this is a high gore film, but he did a wonderful job. I didn't want to alienate the gore crowd with this film, but I did want the blood moments to be character-driven and horrific. I really believe that putting death on screen that's gratuitous or doesn't affect the story is almost irresponsible. I didn't want to be a part of that. This film, when somebody dies, you feel it. It's tough.
I'm sure Cal and Tara Jean can concur, right? That it is very, very emotional.
Absolutely,
very emotional movie.
And you absolutely fed me a perfect segue, because my next thing that I wanted to bring up and what my sneak peek left me with the emotionality was the wonderful filmmaking, and I'm being really serious now. Using Lousy Land, if that's the...
Yes.
So in other words, what
Lousy Land became a character in this movie. It was a wonderful location.
Location. And it was so bleak, and it was so apocalyptic, and just watching that and seeing the bleakness, it was a very...
That whole six-block radius of Long Branch really lend itself to... this film, it gives the film an expensive look.
Really expensive.
That we could not have achieved. They've literally built sets in Yugoslavia for horror films. And the film From Hell, for example, with Johnny Depp, that cost $10 million, and they don't look any better or any more impressive than what we have right there in Long Branch.
And sadly, Lousy Land is no more. Chris caught the... final moments of Lousy Land.
Well, there was a fire in the bottom. Wow. That whole area will be.
So that's gone?
Oh, no, they just sold it off. Oh.
But it will be.
It'll be redeveloped.
It was a marvelous, emotional.
Oh, that's upsetting.
It was a gorgeous cinematic experience.
We have a great look that was provided by.
Fabulous look.
Being able to shoot in those locations, yes.
And even some of the scenes walking under a train trestle, the feeling that you conveyed of desolation, destruction, desolation, solitude.
I spent a long period of time scouting areas that I thought were perfect for
evident.
Particular scenes. But you were talking about that train trestle. That's the Collinswood train platform by the Collinswood Flea Market. And we went there to shoot because I just called up Kaylin and Jason and I said, the snow I need for this scene is happening in 2 hours. Can you meet me there? And we did the scene. Oh. And actually, we're looking. Yeah, poor Kaylin's still remembering that.
Tell us what happened.
Well, that's the scene where she collapses. She's sick. And Jason picks her up and carries her away. That was literally me calling them and saying, I need you there in 2 hours because the snow we're going to get is perfect for the scene. And they showed up. And we're walking along in these
the tracks,
somebody painted, I don't want to be dead, and please don't be dead on the tracks. And I'm going to say, I'm going to take complete credit for this, that somebody's going to say we did this for the film. But these were the fortunate kind of things that happened in this movie that just lend itself. So I made that a part of the scene.
Like the occult graffiti at Lousy Land.
Yes, yes.
So where were you when he called you? Tell me about that.
In bed. It was the weekend, and I am a very late sleeper on the weekend. I can go from sleeping
Too
until
bad.
School is over. You have no idea. I was ready to go to sleep the entire day, and my mom comes into my room. She's like, Kaylin? Oh, no, he didn't.
Yes,
yeah.
I did.
Oh.
It helped your performance greatly, too. I guess I had no idea you were half asleep the whole time.
But it was
your
great,
character
though,
is dying. Her character is basically dying and collapses, and her father picks her up and carries her about...
she had to do that like 20 times.
Yeah, a few hundred feet down these railroad tracks, and poor Jason had to pick her up about 14 times. And I think Kaylin deliberately probably sabotaged a few takes because she was just having so much fun... watching him pick her up and be carried off. But it's a wonderful scene. It worked out very well.
I was proud to deliver to Chris also my partner and friend, the legendary Grindhouse actor John Link.
Oh, well.
Who is in our picture.
He's a unique man.
Imagine he's 4'11", dresses in all black all the time.
Hey, Cal, we could put you holding John Link on top of the Empire State Building. That could be pretty funny.
Kind of looks like Charles Manson's illegitimate son.
Hmm. Oh, that's scary. All right, we're going to take a moment right now just to do a station ID. You are listening to NJ Discover Live Radio. You can go to our website at www.njdiscover.com. You can go to our Facebook page. We have a production page, and if you want to find out what we're doing, we've got TV shows, we have radio shows. We're always out there, always looking for what's going on in New Jersey and talking about people and art and creativity and even charities. We hit those too. So yes. Go to our website and get in touch with us and go to our Facebook page and tell us that you like us because we like what we're doing, right, Calvin?
We like to be liked.
Yeah.
Yes, we do. We do. So, coming back, let's talk about the question. I don't think we touched on it enough, but what separates the Soulless from other films in its genre?
The Soulless is very much a character piece. It's a drama about a father and daughter. The framework around it is an apocalypse. The framework around it will be familiar to the fans of the George Romero films, but I'm taking this in a way that's very science fiction oriented. This is a 3-year TV series I have in mind that literally takes humanity from this apocalypse to recovering itself. And the David and Peterson and Nicole Peterson are there the entire time, kind of guiding humanity back. And they're fighting a mad scientist person who feels he's God. And basically has some godlike abilities through his genetic research, and is basically trying to recreate the Bible and throughout this series. And he says, "I'm God. I will do this." And he manipulates people in the world and David and Nicole throughout this long period of time. It's a very complex story. We've planted the seed. I see the vision of it being a 3-year TV series right now.
Wow. We were talking before we went on air. I thought it would be a kind of a nice to go from some heavy, serious stuff. If we can go around to the actors and talk about some funny, comical, anecdotal things that went on during the filming.
Oh.
I know there was
Alex has probably many about her death scene, I'm sure. And
jump in. I know there were great variations in temperatures that you had to endure.
Yeah, -20 to 105 was our range. Okay. I am a method director. I made one mistake. I would give people a script about a week ahead of time, to keep things fresh, keep them excited about what they're going to do. Sometimes they wouldn't know until it was coming up, so you could always see the energy in their face. But I made a mistake of telling Kaylin and Alex about the scene where they find a car and drive it.
And
to
tell
that was probably one of the best scenes I've ever done.
Yeah, to tell two 12-year-old girls they're going to get to drive a car around this parking lot for a while was a mistake because I didn't get to do it the next week. It was 2 months later. So for 2 months, I kept... They would, at end of the day shooting, they'd come and go, "When are we going to drive the car?" And I'm like, "As soon as I can." You know, it was that kind of thing. Other than that.
Didn't even mind that it was cold out.
No, they didn't mind that day at all. It was I hope we don't get in trouble when you actually see them driving the car in the film because it's them driving the car. It was all CGI, yes. Totally.
So now the two of you have some really, really nice scenes together and... you know, just as kind of like a mom watching the show, it was really moving to see, you know, I'm afraid to say too much of the story, but with what happened with her mom, you know, mm-hmm. you lost your mom and then you lost both your parents. And when you came together, you found this comfort and it was just so beautiful. So your relationship evolved really nicely. What's your favorite scene between the two of you where there was this like incredible... You know, I'm an actress. I graduated Fordham University as a theater major, and I've done tons of theater and, TV stuff. So I know when you have some of those moments where it's just so real, and you really thought you were there, and you really thought you were in a place where zombies, and you were the only ones left.
They're wonderful. Which moments?
I think where we, really connected was probably during the pool scene, when we were playing pool.
Yeah.
Because I forgot that, honestly, I think we forgot that we were... doing a movie because honestly I suck at pool anyway, but we kept trying to play it like we were really good at it and it was not working,
which was
we
perfect.
Were horrible.
I was worried they were going to ruin the table. I was going to have a shot where they kind of rip the top of the table with the pool sticks.
Look at the table.
I told them, let's just play pool for a while, half hour of. And I just followed them with the camera, mm-hmm. and they forgot we were filming. And it really comes off well.
Yeah, it really does. Film. Beautiful scene.
My favorite scene of the two of them together is when they're talking over the magazines at night. about whether they're going to meet boys. And Melissa says, I want to get my first kiss over with so I can get to the good stuff. And Nicole does not know what the good stuff is. Melissa leans in and tells her what the good stuff is, whispers it. Mm-hmm. And I distinctly remember both of them turning to me and saying, what is she saying to me? And what I said, well, I'm not going to tell you that.
Duh.
And then about 3 or 4 months later, Kaylin comes to me and goes, I know what she was saying. But my daughter still leans into me and goes, Dad, what is he saying? I go, you'll find out eventually. But it's significant later on in the when Nicole is older. It's 12 years before she meets a young man and falls in love with him in the second film. And during that scene, Melissa goes, well, it's not like the Disney movies. It takes way more than a kiss to make a baby. That becomes very significant to the story later on because it becomes you're supposed to say spoiler now.
Spoiler.
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 But,
yeah, spoiler alert.
Every scene in this movie is to kind of make you feel a bonding between father, daughter, and father and the girl, Nicole and Melissa, but also foreshadowing to things that are significant later on in the older Nicole's life. And these two did just a wonderful job. I'm glad you two were friends ahead of time. That helped the performances immensely. But, boy, they learned their lines. I never had to remind them of what... anybody who's worked with child actors before kind of know that it's tough. It can be tough, but they were fresh the whole time. I never had to worry about what part of the scene I could use. You never had to piece together the performance in the editing room.
It's cutting that makes the difference.
Yeah.
Well, you know, editing always is important, but sometimes you're forced to, well, there's 4 seconds I can use, and I have to use that. I never had to do that with these two. Wonderful actresses.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, excellent.
Thank you.
My favorite scene is the wall when you're writing on the wall.
Writing the boys' names.
Yeah.
On
love
the wall.
That scene.
That was fun.
Love that scene.
They did like how I let them forget Harry because I think they were both Harry Styles fans at the time or still are. But I wrote in at the end they forgot to write Harry on the wall and that's how it ends.
You know what I was thinking when they were writing it is they're writing names of boys that they knew that are probably dead. That are gone.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it's these memories of boys that are going on the walls of boys that are gone. So it was very, I'm telling you, there's moments in this movie that are really moving, Calvin,
very
right?
Very moving.
Yep.
Yeah, used a lot of names that were kids from our school that we're friends with, and also a lot of names of stars, fangirls.
Right, of course. Do remember magazine. Some boys being written down that you did have crushes on at the time also. I'm not going
to
go on from there.
I have
say
the samurai sword in the trunk.
Okay, what about, can we talk about the scene you said? You had said that the scene where she gets killed. Can we talk about that? How was that for you? Was it?
Okay.
Lean in, Alex. The world wants to know about this. Melissa's death scene, I consider to be the shower sequence from Psycho.
Yes.
It's our version of that.
Oh, my God.
It was about, like, 25 degrees out. It was very cold, and I had to lay on the wet ground. And
like a pipe broke the night before, I think.
Which
like,
was okay
was
until
everywhere.
The blood started, right?
And then the blood started. And that was just disgusting.
It was definitely.
I think I used about 2 gallons.
Oh my God!
He was like squirting it in my mouth, down my mouth.
Yes, it was so horrible. I couldn't watch it.
It was disgusting, and
it was great.
I would just be like shivering the whole time. And then when we started filming, I was like trying not to shiver, and I was just like, "Oh, come on, please be over."
It was great.
I do remember telling you, Alex, that okay, now you're dead. Don't move at all, and you're like. Don't move at all, Alex.
You're a teacher.
I can't do it.
Was that a one take? Was that one take?
No,
that was a couple
no,
takes.
No,
a few.
No. It was very tough to do that scene because I literally had to do all the shots from one direction at a time, and then do the blood, and then put another direction where you wouldn't see the blood on the background. And then the blood that actually hit her, we did as one series of takes. And then when you cut it all together, you get the feeling of the whole environment, because we didn't have the budget or the time to clean up the set and do it again. Mm-hmm. It was basically, I had to plan it very well to just shoot it all one direction and then go back, and literally behind us, the wall would be covered with blood, and we would start the scene again with the fresh wall on this. What the camera doesn't see doesn't matter. It's something I learned from reading about a Hitchcock film. Hitchcock, MacGuffin, a film Bob and I did right before Soulless, is a Hitchcock spoof. But one thing I learned from reading about Hitchcock is he did a scene for Family Plot with a fake background behind a helicopter. The cinematographer came to him and said, you know, Hitch, if I turn the camera an inch or two either way, you'll see that it's just fake background. And Hitchcock leaned over to him and goes, are you planning to pan an inch or two either way? And the cinematographer goes, well, no. He goes, well, that doesn't matter then. You know, literally what's a half inch off camera doesn't matter. That's the fantasy of film. If I were to pan a half inch one way, you'd have seen Ed with his big squirt gun going like this. You know,
that squirt gun was evil. That was her enemy during the film.
Gun
wasn't
evil.
Even the zombies. It was just Ed's squirt gun.
Yes. I apologized in advance.
Ed got carried away with the squirt gun here.
No, I apologize, but he didn't mean it.
Just a little.
Nobody meant it. Everybody was pretty.
I delivered the Jackson Pollock style gore effects you needed.
Yes, another fun day. Michael, you want to talk about how I made you appear to come out of the helicopter?
Oh, yes.
Yes, that was fun.
I like that. That was wonderful.
I know this place that lands a helicopter the same time, same place every day during the week, and we decided to guerrilla filmmake and add some production value to us. So I called Michael up, and he showed up one morning, and you want to tell what happened then?
He says, this helicopter lands at exactly, what time was it?
7:45 every day.
That was it. So he says, this helicopter lands at 7:45 every day. I want you to go right up to that fence there where the helicopter comes down. And as soon as it comes down and he opens the door, I want you to come toward the camera.
Oh, wow. Wow. Brilliant.
So I went by the fence and I waited there for about 3 or 4 minutes, mm-hmm. and then sure enough, helicopter came overhead, landed. As soon as that door opened,
He looks like he belonged.
Yeah.
You know, he's walking out.
I knew I had just come out of that helicopter.
Brilliant. Somebody watched the film and they go, how much did it cost you to get that helicopter? And I go, $3 in gas and about, you know, the tape. You know, and Mike, that was it. It just works very well to know these environments and the opportunities you can have to add to your film and not get arrested. That's the key.
You're supposed to tell lies about the cost.
No, I'm very proud of the way we look for what we spent. I'm not going to say how much we spent, but if somebody were to come up to me and say, how much was your budget on this, and they said $3 or $4 million, I would probably say, thank you. I think that's what it looks like.
Right.
It does.
Yep, it does.
Absolutely.
Yep.
As we wind down, I want to get some good points in. Do you have any comments on distribution?
I have a group from New York City that has been interested in the film from the beginning, and they want first look, so which is always encouraging. And I have a couple of contacts with some networks. I really see this as a TV show, and what I'm hoping is they say, we love this, now go reshoot it. Here's money, go reshoot it. Because what we've done is good, but it's not something you would put on network television.
Say that the quality of the piece is not good.
No, it just production value-wise, we would have to raise the bar.
The slickness. I hope you'd bring the same cast back if you reshoot.
I'm going to try. I'm going to go to bat for everybody. If we should become a series, I'm going to go to bat for everybody who worked on this. I can't see any way to change or would want to, unless Kaylin, stop growing, because you can't play a 12-year-old anymore.
I'm sorry. I couldn't play a 12-year-old when I was that height anyway.
It's very funny because
it's a good thing Jason's tall. It's a good thing.
We started this movie a year and a half ago, and Kaylin, I can tell which scenes Kaylin did early and which ones later, because she's aged about 3 years in the face. you know, and her acting ability and everything is matured. She's matured throughout the whole process. So I watch the film, and I can literally say, that's Kaylin of a year and a half ago, and this is Kaylin of a year of 3 months ago. And so that's the problem we have. I'm going to keep that in mind in the future of casting somebody at your age for this process.
There were some scenes where we were like, okay, I was this tall, now I'm this tall.
Right.
Okay, my hair was much blonder. Oh, wait, now it's really brown.
Well, she had to get into
everything
her Z-Day, Z-Day jeans and shirt again.
Oh, don't eat to
And fall. I thought she was going to do a Lou Ferrigno thing, like if she bent the wrong way, the shirt would split or something, God. Because she doesn't really fit it anymore. But when you watch the movie, I don't think you notice that, but no. I see it. I see it when I watch it. I go, this is a you matured immensely. As an actress.
Thank you.
As an actress. In terms of distribution, Bob and I here will be meeting with people soon. We're going to be showing it to a lot of people. I really feel this is a film. The first film works on its own as a movie. There are seeds planted for what happens afterwards that I think are important. But I'm going to sell the first film as a film on its own and then go to the distributors. Oh, by the way, there's part two and three. How much do you want to
well,
give me for
Well, there's like
those?
Lord of the Rings. Is
This
we
is the Lord
enough,
of the Rings
for
of...
three parts there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Or seven episodes on a TV
it's show. It's 10 episodes of a show or three movies.
Right.
So, this is the Lord of the Rings of independent horror film is how I've been looking at this.
I love that. I love that
Originally, I had a three-hour film in mind. It's become 7.5 hours, and that's because of the... going from the abridged to the unabridged version of my story. Nothing got changed dramatically, but I was able to introduce later on, there's a character called Kelly Landis, played by Braden Fraser, wonderful young actress who's six and looks about six, who's a little girl raised by a zombie mom. And she's developed a number of special abilities because she's been in a society of primitive people. But she is a soulless. Her mother instinctually doesn't understand what motherhood is, but raised her like a mom would, protect her and so forth. And Nicole Peterson finds this young girl, adopts her, and they have a special bond. But that's a storyline that I was not able to do originally, but I found Kelly... it's wonderful. You should be a casting director, by the way. I described this character, and she said, I know a little girl could play that. And it worked. That's how it went.
Phenomenal memory and great presence.
She did a scene with Jason Probst where Jason forgot a line, and Braden leans forward and goes, you're supposed to say this. So that I can say this, you know, and she remembered not only her lines, but his, and it was about, she'd gotten the script about 4 hours before we shot it.
Yeah, now Jason, amazing. Jason Props, he's not here, hopefully he's listening, but he was wonderful yes, in the yes. show, he really.
This film would not have worked if we'd had a weak link in any of the cast, especially the main ones, but the casting is just great. Yeah. Can't say enough about the casting.
Now, can we tell people, because now we have the buzz going, you know, NJ Discover's been putting out the articles and getting people to know about it. We're on 2 minutes left. Thousands of people know about this now. How can they stay in touch before it actually comes out? Where can they go? Anything, website or Facebook page?
We have a Facebook page. We have 1,300 people on there now. I expect to have 70,000 by the end of this radio show.
All right.
Okay. And we have... The Soulless Movie at Weebly.com, our website. There's going to be a number of different avenues for people to explore now, too. There's YouTube videos that I'll be putting out. Actually, a lot of the things that have been posted in the past, I'm going to start eliminating because I want everybody to be fresh and clear. So you guys are some of the privileged few who've gotten to see a lot of the material that I will now be actually removing from sites soon because I don't want any spoilers out there. So that's where to follow right now. We have a premiere for, and our Lionheart LLC that Bob Cleary's
we have a link on there. We have a link on there.
And that's a website, the Lionheart?
Lionheart LLC.
Okay.
And that has a Soulless.
Okay. All right. So
and a cast and crew premiere is May 14th, and that's what I'm preparing for right now.
And where's the location, Chris?
Well, I don't want anybody to know that because that's an invite only.
Spoiler alert. Well, thank you so much, Calvin. We have 1 minute.
There's never enough time because there's so much more.
Four.
But,
three.
What? How many seconds are
there? Bye, everybody. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
This was wonderful.
Thank you, Cal.
This was a special, special night.